is a secret to creating a successful enterprise? Is it raising capital? Is it creating a good brand image? Or is it access to the latest technology? What is the secret to success? In the previous edition, we had the experts, leaders, analysts, and investors share the core funding issues. In this edition, as we continue our focus on funding, we look more at the pitfalls, the government initiatives, and of course, the SME exchange.
All of us today talk about India as an economy where we know it is growing constantly, and we as SMEs are providing a vast amount of input as far as the industrial or the economic growth is concerned. But at the same time, I'm also sure that most of us are not even aware of what the government is actually doing for us.
Rajesh here, I'd like to ask, Rajesh, you are aware about most of the incentives that the government has planned and has offered and have been, you know, utilized by various entrepreneurs across India. Would you just sum that up for us?
If you really ask me, there are more than 50 schemes which are being operated by the Ministry of Micro, Small and Medium Enterprises, Department of Science and Technology, Ministry of Commerce, Ministry of Food Processing, and also other segments or divisions, departments within the government's within the government of India. Also, there are schemes operating at the state level. Different state governments are there. But most of these schemes which are being operated are through intermediaries or through associations, so that it creates an enabling environment. So instead of directly reaching out to the SMEs, they say that, okay, if you have associations, you could come to us, and then we'll be providing support for marketing support, for even taking conventions abroad, or to participate in trade fair, buyer-seller meet, or even holding such meets in India. So there is a great amount of subsidy which is there. Under that NMCP, National Manufacturing Competitiveness Program, there were a host of schemes which were there, but mostly on a pilot scale basis. Few schemes, although, hopefully should really become models for further development and providing access or facilities to, for instance, lean manufacturing was one important thing. Yeah. There was also cluster development programs which are happening. But then I would like to also mention that there are 2-3 schemes which are focused on the enterprise unit level. And they are very much important from the enterprises, but the utilization has been very, very low. There is one such scheme called Credit Linked Capital Subsidy Scheme. Now, not more than 10,000 entities in its 12 years since it is on have actually availed of this facility. So in case if you go for a technology upgradation, there are some industries which are eligible, which are considered to be eligible. And almost all the manufacturing sector industries or technologies have been put on the DC MSME website. It is available there. You can have a look at that. So even if it is not listed, you can always make an application for coverage of your technology or industry for the purpose of this. The only condition is that you can avail of the subsidy only if you are availing funds or loans from institutions like banks or SIDBI or TIIC or SFCs similarly. Now, 15% cost of the plant and machinery for the technology which you are using is subsidized. So that goes on to repay either your loan amount, or it could be seen as offsetting your interest cost. So basically you can finance the technology without actually paying for it in terms of finance cost. So that's a very, very beautiful scheme. And once you've implemented it, there are some relaxation that you can actually avail of it within 6 months from the implementation of the technology. And the process is very simple. In fact, it is given on the website also. It has to be availed through the bank. So if you do not want to take loan and you still want to use this, it is not possible. Secondly, there is another scheme called Credit Guarantee Fund Trust for small and micro and small enterprises. Now, this is where if you want to avail loan without offering any collateral security, the Credit Guarantee Fund provides 75% guarantee of the total loan amount that has been taken, subject to a maximum cap, say of 50 lakhs or up to 1 crore. If it is the loan is up to 50 lakhs, the guarantee available is 75%. From 50 lakhs to 1 crore, the guarantee available is only 50%. So if the loan is between anywhere between 50 lakhs and 1 crore, it is it could be around 67%. That could be the guarantee that would be available. Now, well, credit-linked capital subsidy scheme is a one-time, subject to a maximum of 15 lakhs that you can avail in your life, in the lifetime of the enterprise. Credit guarantee is an ongoing affair. So even if your loan has been repaid, if you contract a fresh loan, then also you can get the guarantee cover.
SMEs are fairly good in getting off and taking off really pretty well because of the innovation and other kind of things that they come with almost inherently built in. But once they start off, for them to sustain their business and go to a level which requires a certain amount of greater level of organization, greater discipline, more amount of systems and processes, and continuing to innovate, I think that is where I think most of the SMEs actually fall out. One of the issues that I always feel get worried about is that many of the SME owners really don't know the difference between their personal money and the company money, right? Every time there is a marriage in the SME owner's house, it's quite likely that a fair amount of that expenditure will actually come from the business and the cash box of the business and not from one's personal cash box. So this kind of fuzziness of personal interest and the organization interest is the starting point of a lot of troubles. So as a result, what really happens is that they tend to get into some kind of a cash jam, or they borrow money for the very short term and put money into, let's say, buying plant and machinery. Okay, take a 3-month unsecured loan from a friend and then buying a large machinery for expansion, which is going to give you cash flows over a 5-year period. So when the time comes to pay the 3-month loan off, you are in a desperate situation. So it's a fair amount of mismatch of funding and the need, a fair amount of mismatch or a fuzziness between personal money and organization's money, and a certain inability to scale up and organize oneself quickly enough for growth, which is really required. And of course, JT, when he was here for a very brief while, he did touch upon this whole issue of listening too much to your chartered accountant who only tells you to not pay taxes is another issue which we really have to contend with. Because in the process of saving the 30%, most of us lose sight that we are actually letting go of 70%, which is due to come to us. So it is that certain misplaced priority which also needs to be corrected. Because if we actually do all these little corrections, which are not very difficult to really achieve, it's just that you need to look at oneself or one's business in the mirror and say, okay, what is right and what is wrong, and we need to make those amendments. I see this mentality or the old mentality that I spoke about actually changing progressively and in a very pretty quick manner, because the next generation today is really coming up and taking the mantle of growing the business. So, and by and large, I see their level of education and awareness is far greater than one generation before. So I see a lot of hope in this kind of change, and a lot of people are today very happily taking external advice, whether it is in the form of kind of an outsourced CFO, not a chartered accountant, but an outsourced CFO who genuinely works with 5 or 6 companies as if he's their CFO and really provides a lot of advice.
Coming up after the break, we tell you all that you need to know about the SME Exchange. The NSE SME platform is intended for SMEs with high growth potential, whose post-issue paid-up capital is 25 crores or less. The platform promises to offer a new and alternate asset class to informed investors. But in the bigger scheme of things, what does it mean for the SMEs? And how does an SME get listed? Ravi Tyagi of NSE has the answers.
Why an SME exchange? Do we need an SME exchange? When we have a main exchange, we have, you know, private equity, we have venture capital. So where does it fit in? And that's a very critical question, I think, for all of us to understand, to get a right perspective of this market and its possibilities. See, there is no doubt there are huge number of companies in India which sitting with a lot of opportunities. Yeah. Typically, this kind of exchange works not in all countries. You know, it's not like it's working in 100 countries, a junior market. Junior markets work in some kind of macro environments which, you know, they fit in at the right time. So first critical requirement in any country is that, you know, that country should be witnessing very high and sustained growth for some time. And that should be, you know, visible in future also. And that's happening in India today. When this kind of growth happens in any country which India is witnessing for the first time in the last 10 years, suddenly you start seeing, you know, new sectors emerging, new kinds of businesses emerging which were not there. So a lot of people always talked about OTCI. But if you see 20 years ago, India didn't have technology sector. India didn't have banking, finance. India didn't have insurance, private insurance, infrastructure, retail, organized retail, biotechnology. You know, these were the big sectors which were not there at all. We were largely a brick and mortar economy. But when this kind of economic growth comes in a country, suddenly, you know, the opportunities are big. New sectors start opening up and huge opportunities are there for good quality entrepreneurs to you know, really exploit. But there is huge requirement of capital now. Now this capital requirement is huge for SME businesses, and this is like a venture kind of requirement. You know, any person, any investor who puts money in a small company is a venture investor in his mind. So another thing that you require for this kind of platform to work is that you require a lot of investors who understand small companies and want to invest in those small companies. While there are companies, huge number of companies with very good business models in country today, very good governance, new kind of managements, and very forward-looking people. But do we have enough number of investors? So first risk investors are the VC investors who are putting money in small companies, but that's not good enough, that's not sufficient. But there are, you know, there would be 1 lakh more investors in this country today who can put 10 lakh rupees and who are looking to put 10 lakh rupees every year in unlisted companies. They're looking for opportunities for that, you know, put money patiently in some company where they're happy with the management, where happy with the growth story. So if those 1 lakh investors can come on a platform, and that's 10,000 crores of capital per year for small companies. Now, why not on the main exchange? See, it's very critical. The small IPO market, the small company markets gets overshadowed in a big exchange. You know, people don't take it seriously. A small company, I don't think, is taken seriously on a main exchange. It gets overshadowed. And, you know, there is liquidity issues. There are the investors are not able to, a common man on the street can't, you know, really make out what is the right thing to do, where to invest, where not to invest. Because typically you will expect a man on the street when he goes to a big main exchange to have, you know, very sound companies there, whether it's HDFC Bank, something like that, he's safe to invest in that. Small companies carry risk, but they have very good potential for the people who are informed and who can gauge those risks. For them, you know, it's like a venture kind of opportunity. So a separate platform brings these companies on a separate platform and also brings those informed investors on a separate platform. And we feel that there is a big community of investors, whether it's VC investors, private fund investors, and a lot of HNI investors who are looking for such opportunities. If they all aggregate on a single platform, it becomes a very good and thriving market. What is the, you know, regulatory framework? It's a platform which is regulated by the regulator. So SEBI regulates it. It's not an unregulated platform like some junior platforms are. Number two, who can be the issuers on this market? It's any SME with post-listing paid-up capital less than rupees 25 crores can get listed here. So the definition does not put a cap on issue size or market cap. It's just defined to your paid-up capital. Depending on your capital structure and depending on the valuation of your business, you could raise 10 crores here, you could raise 100 crores here, You could raise less than that. You could raise more than that. So it's not exactly a very small exchange like raising 2 crores or 3 crores. It could be anything. Worldwide, these platforms are also known as alternative platforms. It could also be a place where, you know, big funds invest on it. Big funds do secondaries on this. And so it becomes a place for risk investing somewhere around the venture industry or in the center of venture industry. So any company planning to raise 10 to, you know, I would say 100 crores, there, this platform is good for them. As far as we go, we have not put any special big conditions for profitability. You know, we have put 2-year EBITDA positive companies and 3-year track record, which is largely because these platforms are supposed to be for relatively early stage companies. You know, this profitability for any equity investor today, especially who's investing in small companies, ask any venture capital fund, is not a criteria for giving money. The criteria for giving money, as the other speaker said, is, you know, how good is the business model, how big is the vision, and whether they have the team and wherewithal to implement what they are promising. I think, you know, equity investors look for this combination rather for profitability, so we are flexible on profitability aspects. The new SEBI guidelines say that for the main exchange now, you will have to have 15 crore, you know, PBT average for some time before get listing. So this platform automatically now is, you know, defining what kind of issuers can come here and what kind of investors can come here.
Coming up after the break, we find out what a fund manager is actually looking for. Stay tuned. The secret to building a successful enterprise lies in not just choosing your partners, but rather understanding what exactly that they are looking for.
When you meet up with a person, first in a small company which may have a few people working for it, I think it's important to evaluate the person himself. And once you, so what you have to evaluate is whether this person knows what he is doing or he doesn't know what he is doing, or he is just doing well today because of circumstances, or is there a strategy behind it. Now, as an example, we have seen all these cell phone companies which started off, they were huge advertisers in IPL, I think the previous World Cup also. But their strategy was built around what? Mimicking existing brands cheaply, importing out of China and selling in India, and giving hardware features, and they were not so high on software. The entire market changed. Market moved towards smartphones. The existing players, established brand, made their existing phones on the lower end cheaper. Chinese currency appreciated against the US dollar by 10%. Indian rupee depreciated 25%. So 35% advantage gone. So what happened? Now these companies are tethering, making losses, and no one really talks about them. So, and I don't see people buying those phones any longer. So I think the sustainability of the business is important. So when fund managers start evaluating small companies, they'll see what has made you do well in the past and whether you have the vision of doing well in the future, whether you'll exist after 3 to 5 years or you'll just go away somewhere and will not exist. So that's very important. Secondly, I think what's also important is where I have seen people make, fund managers make a lot of money in small companies is where the company does better than what is expected out of it. So when you go evaluate the company, he's doing some X, Y, Z thing. Now, when you are evaluating that company's management, do you think that he has the ability to do much better than what he's doing today? And if that evaluation is successful, I think that's where you'll get money much more than what you would expect. And that's where fund managers also tend to make much more money. In a small company, in today's date, I think financial control is very important. And I think that's something which people, which fund managers will look at. Typically, as an entrepreneur or a person who starts a business, you wouldn't know so much about finance. You will start your business, you have passion for it, you keep on doing it. But eventually, there needs to be financial control. We have seen so many companies who have got into the trap of FCCBs, they have raised foreign currency convertible bonds, which they are not able to repay today because they could never judge the way the rupee would fall or where the stock market would be. There are companies who took derivatives from foreign banks. Now, these derivatives, I as a fund manager cannot understand. So how is a small company supposed to understand those derivatives? People bought into those derivatives. A company which used to make 10 crores profit took derivative exposure which has landed him into a loss of 100 crores. So I think those kind of instances have happened. So I think people are looking at financial controls very carefully these days to see whether the company is well managed financially. I think on a financial basis, what we've seen is stock markets, if you look at in India, they would have given a return of maybe 17-18% per annum over the last 20 years still, despite the kind of market we have seen last 5 years. So if an investor is looking to invest into a smaller company, he will look at maybe a 25% kind of return. So whether the company has the ability to grow at that rate and generate that kind of return for the investor, I think that's something which the investor will be looking at.
There is this common perception that you get in a PE or a venture capital firm to come into your company and you've lost your company.
See, you have to exercise your diligence in choosing what type of PE fund or what type of investor you're getting in, just as the way the fund is doing diligence to see what kind of companies they are getting in. Having said that, as in there are, as long as your performance of the company is good, my experience is most investors as in restrict themselves to periodic board meetings and MIS, etc. Only when there is a faltering in performance, which is where they try to bring in value addition. So otherwise, their involvement is largely on strategic matters, as in acquisition or IPO or overseas expansion and those kind of or large capital expenditure. They don't have the bandwidth. A typical fund will have 15 investments or a smaller single fund. So if they are managing 3 or 4 funds, it could be 50 to 60 investments. They don't have the bandwidth to go and micromanage all the 60 of them on a day-to-day basis. Okay, they might help you in hiring a good CFO, they might help you in hiring a CEO, they might help you in those kind of strategic transactions which you're planning. But otherwise, if the going is good, they don't trouble you.
In the next episode, we take you through part 3 of Secrets of Success, SME Branding and Technology. Tune in next week.